This is Chernobyl, the site of the world's worst nuclear meltdown, and it's so radioactive that it'll be uninhabitable to humans for thousands of years. This is Hiroshima and this is Nagasaki, two cities in Japan that were attacked by nuclear weapons much more powerful than the meltdown at Chernobyl. Yet fast forward 70 years and both cities are beautiful, thriving metropolises. But why? I've thought about this for far too long, and today, let's see if we can't figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by Delete Me. It's the 12th of April, 1945, a day that would alter America's history. The nation's leader, President Roosevelt, surrendered his last breath to an unanticipated heart attack, merely 82 days after his presidential inauguration. Suddenly, the mantle of leadership fell upon Harry S. Truman. The wheels of governance didn't pause, and by April 25th, Harry Truman was already deeply engrossed in forming the United Nations. On one such busy day, Secretary of War Henry Louis Stimson discreetly disclosed to the newly appointed president about a secretive endeavor, the Manhattan Project, their attempt to harness the destructive power of the atom. Fast forward to July. President Truman is having conversations at the Potsdam Conference when he finally receives the news he had been eagerly awaiting. The first nuclear test, codenamed Trinity, was a resounding success. The US threatens Japan with a new powerful weapon in the Potsdam Declaration, urging its leadership to surrender, but they choose defiance, sealing their fate. In the early hours of August 6, 1945, Colonel Paul Tibbets and his crew embark on a deadly mission aboard the B-29 Superfortress Enola Gay, headed for Hiroshima. At 8:15 a.m., the first atomic bomb, Little Boy, was unleashed, decimating the city and immediately claiming nearly 80,000 lives, with thousands more succumbing to the effects of radiation. 3 days later, Nagasaki suffered a similar fate, with the detonation of the second bomb, Fat Man, marking the end of the war and thrusting the world into the atomic age. 5,000 miles away and 41 years later, Deputy Chief Engineer Anatoly Dyatlov is looking at the dashboard in front of him, making sure that everything is in order for the reactor's safety test. By now, mankind has mastered harnessing the power of the atom for more peaceful purposes. It is April 25th, 1986. Everything looks good, so they shut down Reactor 4's core cooling system at 2 p.m. in preparation for the test. At 11:10 p.m., the less experienced night crew of operations takes their shift, and Dyatlov gives the operators a thumbs up to proceed with the test. Before running the test at 12:28 a.m., power plummets in the reactor, so the inexperienced operators remove the control rods in an attempt to bring the power back up. It is now 1:23 a.m. on April 26th. With the control rods still removed, the operators begin the test by shutting down the turbine and cutting power to the reactor's cooling pumps. There is a power surge. The operators panic and try to insert all the control rods to shut down the reactor, but they jam. Moments later, they hear a series of explosions. A dumbfounded Dyatlov, who is in the control room, refuses to believe that the reactor has exploded and orders the chief of reactor control to climb to the roof and inspect it. Once on the roof, Sinitkov cannot believe the hellscape unfolding before him. Reactor 4 of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant is gone. The magnitude of the explosion and the fires of the Chernobyl power plant is nowhere near that of the atomic bomb. Yet the aftermath is much worse, making it the worst nuclear disaster in human history. We live in a golden age of information access. It makes creating these videos possible, but it's a double-edged sword. Have you ever tried Googling yourself? I have, and it's seriously shocking, and why I signed up for our sponsor, Delete Me. It's crazy to me that collecting other people's personal information online and selling it is a legit business, but here we are. Delete Me is a hands-free subscription service that helps remove your personal information that's being sold online. They remove you from Google and 100 plus other data brokers all year long. Get a privacy report in 7 days, remove all your personal information like phone number and address, monitor sites and repeat removal as needed, and users can even create custom removal requests. I've been a member now for almost a year, and I'm about to receive my fourth quarterly report outlining all the great things that Delete Me is doing for me. And it's not just about you. How about your family members? For me, I worry about my mom and dad, and Delete Me makes it easy to protect your entire family. Delete Me published a wire release on how high levels of political polarization have become the primary driver of online personal information risk, something I've noticed whenever I research these videos. Have you ever heard of the expression, if something is free, you're the product being sold? Well, take back your privacy online. Get that extra peace of mind of having experts on your side and save 20% on all plans with Delete Me using discount code RICKY. Links in the description. Huge thanks to Delete Me and you for supporting the show. After Chernobyl, a radius of 19 miles around the reactor was designated as an exclusion zone because of the heavy radiation contamination. The nearby city of Pripyat had to be evacuated, as well as several other towns near the power plant. Radiation killed everything in the 4 square miles directly around the reactor. The trees exposed to the radiation died and turned a ginger brown, earning it the nickname the Red Forest. Even today, almost 40 years after disaster, the place is still deserted and a nuclear wasteland. But Hiroshima and Nagasaki are the complete opposite. I visited Hiroshima in 2019, and it's an absolutely gorgeous place. There's no radiation and no exclusion zone, other than the protected atomic dome, which is in a UNESCO World Heritage Site and part of the Hiroshima Peace Memorial Park. I was curious about how long it took for the radiation to disappear from Hiroshima, and it turns out that it wasn't long at all. 80% of the residual radiation from the blast in Hiroshima and Nagasaki had burnt out in the first 24 hours, and a week later it had already decreased to 1/1,000,000th. It was so short, in fact, that reconstruction began almost immediately and hasn't stopped since. Check this out. This is a graph of the population of Hiroshima and Nagasaki from 1940, right before the war, to today. That sharp dip you see was the consequence of the bomb. But after that, it's been a steady uphill growth. Well, except for that second dip in the 90s for Nagasaki and the 2000s for Hiroshima, but that's something else entirely. I'll get back to that at the end of the video. Now look at the population graph for the town of Pripyat next to Chernobyl. That's quite the difference, isn't it? It's just flatlined. Scientists estimate that it'll be another 20,000 years before Chernobyl is habitable again. But why? Why the difference? How is it possible that the aftermath of an accident could be worse than that of a nuclear bomb? I pondered this question for a long time. So I did what any good engineer would do. I started researching. We dug deeper and deeper to try to find any evidence that would help explain why this is. I looked at everything. The magnitude of the explosions, the fuel mass, the blast radius, the fuel type, and any other data point I could to try to figure this out. So this is what we know. All three events are related because they all involve nuclear fission energy, right? So let's see how that works. Nuclear fission literally means splitting the nucleus. Some atoms are unstable and naturally break apart. Those are the radioactive isotopes. But we can also force them to split by bombarding them with other particles like neutrons, for example. That initial fission also releases three other neutrons that can make three other atoms break apart and so forth, causing that dreaded chain reaction. The only difference is that in power plants, we want that reaction to be slow and controlled, while in bombs, we want it to be fast and violent. I remember reading once that there was a debate in 1945 about what fuel to use in the atomic bomb, and that part of the reason for the two bombs, horribly as it may sound, was to test two different detonation mechanisms and two different nuclear fuels. So this got me thinking, could it be that the difference between Hiroshima, Nagasaki, and Chernobyl was the fuel? So I looked into it. Little Boy was made of uranium-235, it turns out, and Fat Man was made of plutonium-239. Well, that's not encouraging. Despite the different fuels, both cities recovered just fine from the radiation. Okay, so what was used in Chernobyl? It turns out that the power plant also worked on uranium-235 like the bomb dropped on Hiroshima. So that couldn't be the reason. What about the magnitude of the explosion? There we could start to see the beginnings of an answer, because there is a clear difference between the bombs and Chernobyl. Both nuclear blasts were roughly 100 times more powerful than the explosion at the power plant. But I'll get back to that in a moment, because there was something else that I found that sets these nuclear events apart, which really caught my attention when I first saw it, the detonation altitude. Both bombs were detonated almost 2,000 feet above the ground. When I saw that, I was like, wait, what, really? At first, I thought it was a typo, so I went and corroborated it with different sources, but no, that's actually true. So I thought then maybe it was a glitch in the detonation mechanism, but it turns out that that explosion at 2,000 feet was completely intentional. I had no idea. I always pictured the bomb hitting the ground and leaving a massive crater, but that's not how it happened at all. I had to look deeper, and so I did. And it turns out that you can choose to detonate a warhead from four different heights depending on the effect you're looking for, leading to four very different outcomes. You have high altitude bursts, which are mostly used for the ionizing radiation and strong EMP pulse to disrupt communications and advanced electronics. Then there's subsurface bursts, used to create a large crater and a powerful shockwave that can destroy hardened targets like bunkers, missile silos, or tunnels. Then there are surface bursts, where you can concentrate most of the blast and thermal energy in and directly around the detonation site. But if you want to cause as much damage as possible to the buildings and infrastructure on the surface, a surface burst doesn't really cut it, because the buildings themselves around the epicenter act like a shield that reduces the blast radius. But if you detonate it above the ground, which is called an air burst, that doesn't happen. This maximizes the blast radius and the damage on the surface, and that's exactly what the US was looking for. Not only that, it also turns out that besides maximizing destruction, air bursts also minimize the radioactive fallout of the explosion. That was the eureka moment for me. So apparently the reason why there wasn't so much nuclear fallout in Hiroshima compared to Chernobyl is that the explosion was deliberately planned that way. But why is that? Why does an air burst minimize fallout while a surface burst doesn't? I dig a little bit deeper and I found it's because in an air burst, the fireball never touches the ground, which means that it doesn't suck up any soil, water, or other materials that could become radioactive and fall back down to Earth. The only radioactive byproducts of an airburst are the fission products and the weapon debris, which are dispersed in the atmosphere by the expanding blast and are carried away by the wind. By the time they do fall, they're so diluted that radiation is minimal. This is the complete opposite of what happened in Chernobyl. There, the explosion wasn't just a ground level, but it was inside a containment vessel that blew up. While it was nowhere near as powerful as Hiroshima, the Chernobyl explosion spat out large and small chunks of the highly radioactive nuclear reactor core. Even worse, the fire in the reactor produced tons of radioactive smoke that was carried by the wind far beyond the borders of Ukraine, into Belarus, and other countries. And the rest, as they say, is history. So that's it? Case closed? Not quite. Because there's at least one more difference in the table that I had to look at. Let's look at the table again. Notice anything particularly eye-catching? Let's focus on the amount of nuclear fuel in each case. There's a big difference between Little Boy and Fat Man. Little Boy carried 64 kilograms of uranium, while Fat Man contained only 6.2 kilograms of plutonium. When I looked into why that was, it was only because of the different detonation mechanisms. You see, for an atomic bomb to explode, you need a critical mass of nuclear fuel so that you can get a runaway chain reaction. That's sort of like YouTube videos that need a critical mass of viewers like you watching, sharing, smashing the like button, and subscribing to tell the algorithm to go viral. Anyway, in a bomb, you can't have the critical mass of fuel together in one place, well, because it'll go off. So what you do is separate it into two subcritical masses, and the detonation mechanism puts them back together to make it explode. Fat Man used an implosion-type mechanism that proved to be way more efficient than Little Boy's gun type. The bomb dropped over Nagasaki only needed a tenth of the amount of fuel to yield 40% more explosive power. But that's peanuts compared to the amount of fuel in Chernobyl's fourth reactor. It had, and this is not a typo, 190,000 kilograms of uranium, and at least 5% of it ended up in the atmosphere and the surroundings after the explosion. That's almost 10 tons of radioactive uranium fuel rods with high concentrations of fission products and other radioactive waste spread out in pieces. These fission products include iodine-131, cesium-137, strontium-90, and plutonium-241. Iodine-131 is the most dangerous of all, but it has a very short half-life and there is virtually none of it left at this point in Chernobyl. The story is very different for cesium-137, strontium-90, and plutonium-241. These last for decades and they're highly dangerous sources of radiation. It was a bit strange to see that most of the sources I checked comparing Chernobyl and Hiroshima overlook this obvious difference between the two. It's not just that the fallout in Hiroshima and Nagasaki was milder because of an airburst, it's also the sheer scale of the amount of radioactive material released in Chernobyl. And this brings me back to the magnitude of these detonations. Remember a minute ago when we noticed how the explosion at Chernobyl was around 100 times less powerful than either atomic bomb? Yet the reactor held 29,000 times more nuclear fuel than Fat Man and 3,000 times more than Little Boy. How does that add up? Well, the only reasonable explanation is that Chernobyl wasn't, in fact, a nuclear explosion. It was a nuclear meltdown, which are two very different things. The explosion was caused by hydrogen buildup inside the reactor, not by a runaway nuclear chain reaction. If that had been the case, Lord knows how large the crater would have been. That's an interesting distinction, because when many of us think about nuclear meltdowns, we immediately default to the image of a big mushroom cloud over the power plant and the surrounding city being obliterated. From what I found out, it turns out that really can't happen, because the uranium in the fuel rods are too diluted. It's never enough to reach a critical mass. So no, not even putting Homer Simpson in charge of a nuclear power plant will result in a nuclear explosion. There's one last thing that came up during my research for this video that deserves mentioning. Only a few weeks after the bombing, and even after surrendering unconditionally, Japan was attacked once again. But this time, it wasn't a foreign nation, it was Mother Nature. On September 17, 1945, Typhoon Makurazaki hit the island of Japan, causing massive flooding and washing away bridges all over Hiroshima, Nagasaki, and other cities. The typhoon took another 2,500 lives. However, the floods also dragged much of the residual radiation out to sea. So is that good luck, bad luck? I'll let you decide. Sound off in the comments below. So Hiroshima and Nagasaki aren't radioactive wastelands basically because the bombs are detonated over 1,000 feet above the ground, maximizing destruction but minimizing fallout. The air dragged most of the radioactive debris away before it could settle on the ground. And what little did fall on the ground was washed away by a giant typhoon. In Chernobyl, the story was different. That said, it's important to note that radiation levels in Chernobyl have decreased to about 10% of what they used to be at the time of the accident. Except for the Red Dead Forest, the exclusion zone surrounding the remains of the Chernobyl power plant is actually teeming with both plant and animal life. In fact, you can even visit the site for a short time without risking your life. I'd love to know what you think about that. Does that sound like a bucket list destination for you? Now, we spoke a lot about Chernobyl as the worst nuclear disaster in human history, but the second worst disaster was Fukushima's meltdown in 2011. And if you want to learn more about the Fukushima disaster and all the fallout from that, watch this video next.